Good afternoon, everybody. Today I'm going to talk about the anti-chamber angle changes post accelerated corneal cross-linking 6 months follow-up. So we all know corneal cross-linking is a newer modality in the management of keratoconus to arrest progression. We all know that corneal cross-linking is a newer modality in the management of keratoconus to arrest progression. And the standard protocol and accelerated protocol are there, which the differentiation is only between the intensity of radiation and the timing of exposure. The purpose of the study is to study and analyze the anti-chamber angles, whether they stay stable or decrease or increase after accelerated cross-linking. 26 eyes of 21 patients with progressive keratoconus were studied. This is a prospective observational longitudinal study with 6 months follow-up. Inclusion criteria is progressive keratoconus and palmiprosthetic keratoconus, patients above the age of 15 years. Exclusion criteria, advanced keratoconus and keratoconus post eye drops and those with angle anomalies. After proper clinical examination and indirect examination, mainly the OPSCAN is taken in undilated pupil to take the thinnest pachymetry and anti-chamber depth, and the anti-segment OCT is to measure the anti-chamber angles in 8 meridians. Gonioscopy is done to rule out the angle pathologies. So this is the anti-segment OCT, simultaneously taking the angles at 8 meridians. Under aseptic conditions in OT, topical anesthesia, epithelium is removed in the central 7 mm of the cornea, 0.1% iodine riboflavin drops instill every 3 minutes for 30 minutes, and cornea is exposed to UV radiation, 10 milliwatts per centimeter square intensity for 9 minutes. Eye is thoroughly washed and BSS and B-cell is applied. Post-op medication included antibiotic eye drops and topical steroids and lubricants 4 times per day for 4 weeks. Oral NSAIDs are given to relieve the pain and B-cell is removed after complete reappropriation of the cornea. The follow-up is done on day 1, day 3 and day 7 to see the appropriation, and at week 1, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months to see the uncorrected visual acuity, best corrected visual acuity, slit lamp examination and non-contact tonometry to measure the IOP. OPSCAN and ASOCT was taken for the anti-chamber angles. The data is analyzed by SPSS V20 version. Demographic data is 26 out of 21 patients. Age range is between 15 to 34 years. 13 males were there and 8 females. There were 15 right eyes and 11 left eyes. So these are the results that we got. Best corrected visual acuity showed statistically significant difference post-procedure. The refraction sphere didn't show any significant difference. Cylindrical power showed significant difference. SIMK didn't show any significance. K-max and K-minimum showed statistically significant difference. Mean power in 3 mm area and 5 mm area showed significant difference. Thinnest corneal thickness showed statistically significant decrease. Intraocular pressure didn't show any statistically significant difference. Anti-chamber depth showed statistically significant increase. The angle at anti-chamber angle at 180 didn't show any change, but 0 it showed statistically significant difference. 270 it showed statistically significant difference. Other angles didn't show any difference among the 8 angles. To summarize the parameters which changed, best corrected visual acuity improved, mean diffraction cylinder decreased, K-max and minimum decreased, mean power in 3 mm and 5 mm area decreased, thinnest corneal thickness decreased, anti-chamber depth increased, and angle at 0 and 270 increased. There were no complications intraoperatively and or during follow-up visits. None of the patients had infection, none of the patients showed progression. This mild subthetal haze was seen in all cases. Coming to the discussion, the literature review has showed that there is decrease in keratometric values and anti-chamber depth showed no statistically significant changes in many studies. If the maximum K value is decreased but no appropriate decrease in central ACD, there could be some increase in the peripheral ACD, that may be increase in the anterior chamber angle. In another view, when central 7 mm of the cornea is sensitized with riboflavin, central flattening is happening. If this flattening is acting as an indentation of the central cornea opening the anterior chamber angles, or does the anterior increased covalent bonds are causing only the anterior posterior approximation of the corneal lamellae, or does centrally increased covalent bonds will cause contraction of the central collagen fibers leading to the centripetal pull of the peripheral corneal tissue opening the anterior chamber angles. Before the CXL era, most of the progressive keratoconus patients used to land up in penetrant keratoplasty and dark. After CXL, if the angles are decreasing, we need to screen at regular follow-up to detect early angle glaucoma, early onset glaucoma in CXL treated patients. Moreover, already being thin corneas, false low IOP is possible, and changes in corneal resistance factor after CXL, possibility of increased IOP effect will be there even when the IOP stays unaltered after CXL. And if the angles are opening due to indentation effect because of central corneal flattening post CXL, it may arise as a newer modality in the treatment of glaucoma in future. There are a lot of literature supporting the efficacy of the axillator cross-linking in arresting the progression. And some studies are there which have studied the antechamber angles, antechamber depth, and antechamber volume also, but they didn't show any difference there. Overall review shows accelerated cross-linking stabilizes the progression of keratoconus and endothelial safety is proved. K-max and K-minimum showed flattening of the cornea after accelerated cross-linking. Demarcation line is shallower in periphery than centrally in both procedures, and anti-chamber parameters by Schimpflug principle was done with 6 months follow-up. Unique feature of our study is the first study to use the anti-segment OCT to assess the angles pre and post accelerated cross-linking. Coming to the thinnest corneal thickness, our study observed a statistically decrease in corneal thickness. Many studies, except a few, they also showed decrease in thinnest corneal thickness 3 months post CXL and approaching the pre-operative values after 12 months of follow-up. They probably showed the stromal loss. Thank you.